哦，那接下来我们要进入第二场论文发表啊。那第二场论文发表是我们的欧思鼎神父啊。欧思鼎神父呢，他是我们天主教学术研究院的博士后研究员哦。那他平常他是辅仁大学的哲学博士啊。那最近他都做的研究呢，都是跟这个 AI 还有这个 neuroscience 有关哦，就特别是这个从天主教哲学的角度去省思这些最新的科技哦，为我们的人类社会所带来的一些这种伦理上面的一些议题哦。那今天他的这个论文发表其实也是就是在这个脉络之下去进行的哦。他的标题是 Artificial Intelligence and Neuroscience Research Theological Philosophical Implications on the Church's Notion of the Human Person。 好，那我们现在就欢迎他，谢谢。
好，谢谢。Okay, we'll go back to English, okay? So, it's dialogue between Chinese and English. So, for the past 3 days, we've been talking about the social teachings of the Church and the subject matter of all the social teachings of the Church is the human person. Is the human person. In other words, at the heart of every social teaching is the human person. So whether it has to do with human dignity, human rights, equality of persons, whether it is about the political theology, whether it's about medical health, so everything is about the human person. So, in other words, my presentation today is to invite us to now reflect on how we understand the human person as Christians, as Catholics, and how our own understanding of the human person is being challenged by contemporary sciences and philosophies. So we have for the part emphasized dialogue, and towards the end of John's presentation just now, he talked about dialogue. So for the past 2 years, actually, my research project is to dialogue as a believer, as a Christian, with contemporary science, technology, and philosophy. So that is what I've been doing the past 2 years. To interrogate, to go into conversation, to go into discourse with contemporary philosophical theories that are rooted in evolutionary, naturalistic, monistic, materialistic, philosophical, metaphysical framework. And the implications, both philosophically and theologically, of these contemporary theories to our own Christian faith, especially as it relates to the human person. So that is like introduction to what I'm doing. So the objectives of this paper is to explore the theological and philosophical implications of artificial intelligence, AI, and neuroscience research on the Church's notion of the human person. So, this is my objective. Now, what is the problematic and the question of this, my presentation? In the face of contemporary research in AI and neuroscience, the question is, we need to ask to understand what we are doing. Is the Aristotelian, Thomistic, philosophical, traditional, in other words, the tradition of our notion of the human person as the Church, is the Aristotelian, Thomistic philosophy. So this philosophy that constitutes the epistemological framework of the Church's theological anthropology today, is it still sustainable? That is the question. To enable us to dive in into this discourse. The notion of the Church we've had for roughly about 1,600 years now. No, about 600 years now, or even like 1,500 years, a long history. Today, this notion of the church, does it need deconstruction? Does it need reevaluation? Does it need a new appraisal? Or do we should we remain with the status quo? So, in the intellectual history of the church, beginning from the patristic period, the period of the church fathers, there have been always two intellectual stances. The first is, we need to remain, this is Christianity, we maintain our stand. So in the patristic period, we have Tertullian as a representative of this position. The Christian is his own philosophy. The Christian faith is complete in itself. It needs to work in parallel with any other epistemology. At the same period, there's a different stand represented by Clement of Alexandria, by Origen, and of course, initially, Justice the Martyr, which is my patron saint, which memorial we're going to celebrate in a few days' time. And their position is, we need to understand what is the science of the time, what is the philosophy of the time, how can we use the science and the philosophy of the time to reinterpret, to reconstruct, how can we employ the concept, the categories of the philosophy of the science of the time to systematize and to articulate our faith, the provision of the Christian revelation built on the Paschal mystery of Christ, which is the incarnation, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus. So this has always been a tradition. When we go to the medieval period, during the scholastic era, the same thing happened. At that time, the status quo is the Augustinian tradition. And then there was that challenge. Should we remain with the Augustinian tradition, which is represented by the great Saint Bonaventure? Or, at that time, the status quo, the epistemological status quo then, became the Aristotelian philosophy. So should we interrogate our Christian faith by the Aristotelian philosophy of the time and now reinterpret this Paschal mystery based on this new science and philosophy that is now taken as having the strongest explanatory power when it comes to epistemological framework? Represented by Thomas Aquinas, this second choice was taken. So, Aquinas chose to employ the philosophical framework of Aristotle to give a reinterpretation without casting aspersion on Augustine, his intellectual mentor, to reconstruct and reframe the Christian theology and the Christian anthropology. So you only see that some persons remained with the Augustinian tradition that is rooted in Platonism, but Aquinas chose Aristotelianism and built a new Christian anthropology. However, this Christian anthropology that is Aristotelian and Thomistic became the paradigm, the model, the standard of the church's anthropology, even up to today, this moment. And that is many years ago. But since this period, both in philosophy, both in science, the natural sciences, Aristotelianism has been supplanted by new sciences in our time. But the church philosophical framework that sustains and explains the church's notion of person has remained that of Aristotelian Thomistic tradition. So, the question is, should we choose to operate in parallel with the contemporary scientific and philosophical movement in terms of intellectual framework? Or should we engage in dialogue? Should we interrogate? Should we study what is happening in artificial intelligence? Should we study what is happening in neuroscience and other brain sciences? Should we see the strengths? Should we see the theory that can help us to now reinterpret and reconstruct how we understand ourselves as human beings without casting away the root of every Christian anthropology, which is the Paschal mystery of Christ? I am of this second view, that we not just have to, but we necessarily have to do this. If not, the wave among the intellectuals today that considers religion, especially the Christian religion, as something belonging to old women tales. So in other words, today for many, having faith or being a Christian is considered either you have less intellectual capacity or you are not intellectually in power with the contemporary times. So we need to understand what they are saying and go into dialogue or conversation. So the argumentation and claim of this paper, this presentation if you like, is that in the spirit of the intellectual tradition of the church, which I just exposed, there is need for a new Christian anthropology based on the interpretation and theorization of the Paschal mystery of Christ that is consistent with contemporary science and philosophy, especially as informed by research in artificial intelligence and neuroscience. That is to say, there ought to be a Christian anthropology today that is fully aware, mark that word, fully aware of the theological and philosophical implications of AI and neuroscience research. That is my argumentation and my claim in this presentation. Now, this is the steps, as you can see in the paper already, I use in my presentation. Now, a brief exposition of artificial intelligence and neuroscience. The most critical and fundamental question in the research project of artificial intelligence is the question of intelligence and cognition in general. AI research is aimed at designing and creating non-biological, intelligent, and cognitive systems. It hopes to give cognitive powers to artificial systems. In other words, the question the AI researcher is asking, intelligence or cognitive powers in general, is it only an exclusive capacity of the human beings? Besides a biological constitution or biological system, is there the possibility to design and to create intelligent systems that are not biologically based? For all AI researchers, they are in affirmation that it is possible. And not just that it is possible, they have set out to create and design artificial system, non-natural, non-biological systems that execute intelligent actions. And the evidence is empirical. It's now all over. But whether or not, because what we have today is called artificial narrow intelligence, but the hope and the vision is to get to the point, not just of artificial general intelligence, in other words, creating intelligent systems that have the same level of intelligence with human beings, but to even create artificial systems that have super intelligence, in other words, that have intelligence that supersedes the intelligence of humans. That is the aim and the hope, and they are working on it. But whether they are going to get to that point or not is not the question. The question is the possibility that it is possible that you bring in silicons, silicons is what is used in making all these electronics, and then you put them together, and then they can do and execute actions that you, with your brain, with all your studies in the class, with all your researches, they can do, like the expert systems that performs even more efficaciously in surgical operations than the human medical doctors. So, the question to us is, what is the anthropological implication that AI systems can do what humans by the means of intelligence can do? In other words, in respect to this presentation, the question can be asked us, what are the implications of this research on the church's notion of the human person? Serious questions. On the philosophical problematic between intelligence and self-consciousness. Now, AI systems performing intelligent actions can... The problematic is this. Can they be said to be conscious and even self-conscious? In other words, if I, as human being, I can do mathematics, I can use ordinary natural language, I can perform surgery if I'm a medical doctor, I can take care of the sick if I'm a nurse, I can do whatever. And if now, using silicons, something, a system is designed and built and can do the same thing I'm doing, there are three possible questions to ask. One, is either AI systems, if they are intelligent, because from the actions we can see, they perform certain intelligent actions, if they are intelligent, then these are the possibilities. If they are intelligent, then they should have consciousness or self-consciousness. That is first. The second is, if AI systems do not have intelligence, if they are not self-conscious. So in other words, if they don't have intelligence, then they are not self-conscious. So the first one is, if they have intelligence, then they should be self-conscious. So one, if they don't have intelligence, or they are not self-conscious, therefore they don't have intelligence. Now the third possibility is to assert that intelligence does not or is not required for self-consciousness. So these are the philosophical possibilities. And it's a very important question. So these are the possibilities. Any theologian, any philosopher who upholds self-consciousness for the human being must respond to these possibilities and these questions. Okay, now, let us briefly on neuroscience as the answer to the theories of consciousness and other mental phenomena. Neuroscience is a systematic study of the structure, the development, and the function of the nervous systems of human and non-human animals that generate behaviors. Okay, now, at the heart of science, the science of neuroscience is the understanding of the structure and function of the neuron, singularly or collectively as neurocircuits. In other words, so what the neuroscientist does is to understand the nervous system. Now, the nervous system is made up of, for example, the brain is made up of the neurons and the glia. Now, the neurons, the glia and the neurons are all cells in the brain. The neurons deal with electrical and chemical impulses. There is a transmission of information. That is what the neurons does. So, as you are listening to me, something is going to your ears. Now, your ears have neurons connecting to your brain, the cerebral hemisphere. And then you hear the voice, the sound, and then the sound transmits, and then it goes to your brain. The brain processes it, and through the motor neuron, it tells you what I'm saying, and you understand what I'm saying immediately, so fast. And this is happening in split of seconds. And the interesting thing is that with neurocomputational systems, it is actually faster, especially with the application of quantum mechanics, or what they call quantum computer. So the speed is even faster. than even the speed of the human brain in transmitting the information. So this is interesting and fascinating. And that is why we need to be interested as a church in this thing. So this is what neuroscience does. So the neuron generates, transmits, converts electrical and chemical impulses within a neurocircuit, between neurocircuit and across the central nervous system and the peripheral nervous system. So there are neurons running all over your body that circulate informations. Just like when you open the motherboard of the computer, if you open your computer, you see all those lines. The ones in your body is even more. And that is why information is run so fast. A little pain, you feel it all over your body. The whole neuron systems are firing because of they need to transmit the information. If not, you will die. You will not have feeling emotions. So neuroscience and advancement. So in recent times, remember, just as a brief, I don't know how much time I have left, because this is very interesting. See, at the beginning, you know, it was because of, you know, neuroscience and brain diseases that in the beginning, there was not that intention to study the nervous system per se in itself. But because people were having, by accident, by whatever, they're having problem with maybe some part of them, maybe the language, speech, hearing, so some kind of accident. So neurosurgeons are trying to treat and to cure these diseases. It spurred them into researching and understanding how the nervous system operates and works. And that is how, in other words, it was neuroscience was a bit of trying to cure neuroscientific problems of the mind and body. So, but later on, now neuroscience took a flesh on itself as a science from the 1960s to 1960s. And so now, in the present times, there are a lot of true advancement in technology. See, technology and science, they operate as sisters and brothers. So with advancement of technological devices, now, not only because you cannot take a human brain and open his or her head to begin to search. So usually it is only when somebody has problem with the brain that they have to do surgery for medical corrective purposes. So usually research have always been done with animals, especially with other primates, like monkeys and chimpanzees. Chimpanzees is the closest, if you believe in evolutionary theory, to the human person, the hominids. So what happens is this, but the monkey cannot do mathematics. The monkey cannot speak Chinese, cannot speak Igbo. So when I have a problem with speaking, when you go to open the brain of the monkey or the chimpanzee, it may not be able to research to deal with that. So it was difficult to really study and understand better the brain and the nervous system. But with improvement in technological devices, a lot of devices have been created, have been developed, that can enable the neuroscientists to see your brain in real time. And these are some of them: the positron emission tomography, single photon emission computerized tomography, functional magnetic resonance imaging. We know about this, fMRI is very popular, and the magnetoencephalography. So these things, I wish I can get some of the pictures, but you can type them, you see them. So they put your head there. Even some of the time when we go to do general body checkup, you go through all this, and they can see your brain. They can see how it is firing. They put a music, as you're listening to the music, they see how, which neuron is at work, enable to make you to enjoy the music. If you're not enjoying the music, they can see it. They can read your neuron and see why you are not enjoying the music. Why you don't like this music, but you like that music. What is the neuron? What is working at real time? At real time. So this is what is going on, beloved people of God. So now, the church's notion of the church. There's no need of going to read all the encyclicals in the church. It is simply a synthesized in Gaudium et Spes. Because you read Gaudium et Spes, it gives you the church's philosophical notion, how we as the church understand the person. And my claim is that it is still the Aristotelian Thomistic one. And whereby the person is understood as one unitary, a whole, however, of two substances, material and spiritual. the body being material, the soul being spiritual. And then it implies the will, the conscience, the consciousness, and others. So without going into deep, because we are all Christians, we all know this, but it is interesting to know that at the beginning of the Gaudium et Spes, the heart, the Gaudium et Spes itself brought out the anthropological question. It puts the anthropological question, what is man? What is the human being at the heart of that constitution on the church in the modern world? I don't want to go into the history of it, what Voti is doing with TV Lubak and Henry Lubak and other things, the whole conversation that went on, how it led, because at that time, John Paul II, then as Archbishop of Krakow, was already articulating and reflecting on his work on the human person that later resulted to his bestseller, Ozaba Ichen, the acting person, or the person and art, which was my part of my doctoral dissertation. You can read this in the library of the school. And how I took it with Confucian philosophy. Now, you can read this. This is, we know this, the body, soul. Now let us go to the heart of the issue, the question and the challenge to this church's notion of the human person, which is dualistic. The question is, contemporary research in sciences and philosophy are challenging our present notion of the human person because it is based, as I said earlier, on evolutionary naturalism and monistic materialism. What is evolutionary naturalism? It means that it is taking that the human being is we are all senior brothers and sisters of other animals. So there is that evolutionary development that led to what we are today. So we don't need to go and begin to appeal to Genesis chapter 1, to God creating the human being. In other words, all our theology of the human person being created in the image and likeness of God according to Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, you are just singing. It doesn't make sense to them. Okay. That's the reminder. So naturalism means that anything that cannot be explained by the natural sciences, physics, chemistry, and biology, does not exist. Anything that exists should be explained by these sciences. Monistic materialism means there is only one reality, and that reality is material. Anything spiritual, anything that we cannot see with our own sense perception or by the use of improved system like telescope, like microscope, or that we cannot mathematize by looking at their mathematical and physical relationship does not exist. So which means that everything about the soul, even the mind, even consciousness, even self-consciousness, some will argue, does not exist. Okay, because of time, there are three persons which I expose in my work, which you can read. John Searle and Dennett, both of them believe that the mind and the mental phenomena, including consciousness, ought and should be explained and can be explained by the brain sciences. The more we understand how the brain and the other nervous systems work, the more we have a more comprehensive understanding of our brain. However, John Searle believed that we have mind and we have consciousness. Dennett, a philosopher, both of them are philosophers, Dennett does not believe that there is mind and there is consciousness. Consciousness for him is an illusion. We think we are conscious, but we are not conscious. Finally, I am making in this paper, in this presentation, a recommendation for a new approach. And that new recommendation, I call it neuro-theological Christian anthropology. Neurotheological Christian Anthropology. What does it mean? It requires four elements. One, it must affirm the unity of each human person as created in the image and likeness of God, which is already the standard. It must affirm the dualism of two substances, material body and spiritual soul, which is what we have. However, now the difference between this proposition and what we have been, that is Aristotelian Thomistic, is this. This, we must try to establish these 2 points, not based on Aristotelian Thomistic metaphysics alone or at all, but on contemporary sciences of the brain. And finally, it must be rooted in the Paschal mystery of Christ. In other words, in the revelation of the Paschal mystery of Christ, how can we, instead of getting the contemporary philosophies and sciences based on the brain sciences, profound or propose a Christian anthropology? Thank you very much.
好哦，我们谢谢欧神父非常精彩的演讲，相信也提供了很多思考的材料，待会也希望在问题讨论的时候可以有一些回响。好。